HarperCollins and Harper Audio present When I Was Your Age, Life Lessons, Funny Stories, and Questionable Parenting Advice from a Professional Clown by Kenan Thompson. With dibs bare, this is Kenan Thompson. Hello, everyone. Welcome to my book. My name is Kenan Thompson, and I hope you enjoy. Let's get it started. We will start with our dedication page, where I wrote, "To my entire family, thank you, and I love you." Family is everything. Family could be, you know, my actual family or friends or fans, you know, the entire world. We all should be one family. So that's family to me. Just FYI. Prologue. How long have we known each other? Either you, your kids, or your kids' kids have grown up with me. I've been on your TV or movie screen since I was a kid, more than 30 years now, from D2 to Mighty Ducks, all the way up to my latest sitcom, Kenan. Funny thing is, after all those years, I don't think people know the real me. I guess that's my fault, because most of my life, I've been playing crazy characters and kooky costumes on sketch comedy shows like All That and Saturday Night Live. Basically, my life comes down to two things, comedy and my family. All I ever wanted to do, as far back as I can remember, was make people laugh like my hero Eddie Murphy. On SNL, I've been smack dab in the middle of the pop culture zeitgeist every week for 20 years and met every famous and super famous, what up, Obama, person on the planet. I'm kind of like Forrest Gump, except I like my shrimp only like three ways. At the same time, I'm an uncool dad stumbling my way through parenting my two little angels, Georgia and Gianna. They're 9 and 5 years old, and they would much rather be hanging out with their friends than listening to me tell them to keep their elbows off the table or cut down the screen time. They don't even use the word screen. I feel like a dinosaur using technical words like that. When I text with Georgia, she'll say, "Why do you use so many exclamation points?" And I say, "'Cause I'm old. I've been through a lot, and now I believe I'm ready to dole out some advice, even if I'm not exactly qualified. Hey, you kids, new parents, fellow fathers, budding comics, aunties who wanna pinch my cheeks, I got something to say. And maybe you can learn from my biggest mistakes and my most triumphant victories. There's something for everybody here. I think I have a fresh, funny take on fatherhood, too. Am I doing it right? No idea. But I'm still ready, willing, and able to give my 2 cents. All I know is I'm doing a lot of things different than my own parents, and sometimes that's good, sometimes that's not so good. My parents raised 2 boys, and I'm raising 2 girls, so there's a learning curve. My brother Curran and I were like 2 peas in a pod. My girls argue a lot more. I have to mediate on the fly. I mean, if we're in the car, pretty much the only words I can get out before our destination are, "Stop fighting with your sister." I might be able to remind them that, hey, they are sisters and they should love each other, because at the end of the day, that sibling bond is the strongest thing on the planet, and they need each other, because once their world gets bigger, they'll have to deal with all these other people's nonsense. Now, my upbringing was just different. Unlike me, my kids can afford a starter jacket. They're back in style again, little birdie told me. But they haven't really experienced black church, which was a huge part of my upbringing. Not sure my dad and his buddies would have ever taken my friends and me to Disney World without the moms and their purses stuffed with supplies for every situation, crayons, snacks, Barbies, clean undies. A daddy's day out with his daughters to the Magic Kingdom is great on paper, but maybe more stressful than performing live television. You gotta navigate girls' bathrooms. Say no to souvenir stuff like every 20 feet. Avoid tummy aches after too much sugar stuff. Yeah, good luck, parents. Speaking of, I have 2 young ladies who will definitely be dealing with body image stuff soon, something I know a lot about. Being very publicly known as a big dude, people have been in the news a lot talking about it, and I'll talk about it too from a fresh perspective, the black male point of view. There are some deeper topics in here like my evolving and ever-changing perspective on race, not only being a black man, but one of the rare, at one time, token black cast members on SNL. For the SNL fans, I've got inspiring advice about the ups and downs of working in showbiz, and specifically on that iconic show. I went from playing forgettable bellhops and waiters to winning over the entire Hispanic community with my hungry David Ortiz bit. Don't worry, I got the juicy stuff too. I've had so many brushes with the rich, Musk, and infamous Palin. I've seen a lot of SNL's most legendary cast members like Andy Samberg, Amy Poehler, and Kristen Wiig come and go. I've seen Tina Fey rewrite a sketch right before a dress rehearsal and rewrite it all again right after. I've shared an office with Colin Jost and worshipped Maya Rudolph. You guys, my fan base is very diverse. And I'm not just talking about racially, though that's true too. Fancy research suggests, after me, my fans' favorite celebrities are Chance the Rapper, shout out, and Bette Midler. Not sure about the wind beneath my wings. They probably know more about the wind after I eat some wings. Oh, that's good. Now, one of the stories I love to tell is about the time back in the early days of SNL, Seth Meyers and I had to drive up from NYC to do a stand-up show at the University of Rhode Island. But when we got to the car rental place, Seth didn't have a driver's license and I didn't have a credit card. The person behind the counter was not having it and tippity-typed on her computer annoyed, barely tolerating us with her hateration. We asked to see the manager and an older black lady came out, instantly recognized me and smiled from ear to ear. "Oh, here you go, baby," she said sugar sweetly, immediately handing over a set of car keys. "Have fun, fellas." Yeah, I have that sort of genial familiarity. My baby face has always been a blessing and a curse. It definitely makes me super approachable. I'd say I'm like a nice Udi, cozy and not controversial. I just got a targeted Facebook ad for the Udi, so it's fresh in my mind. It's basically a ripoff of the Snuggie, but instead of a onesie, it's a soft, oversized hoodie with different designs on it, like garlic bread or Harry Potter. Anywho, I have a deep connection with my audience. I've been in mainstream fare and or on network television since 1992. Damn. So my brand is extremely family friendly. It's so friendly, people love to come up to me and talk to me about the projects I've done that make them feel nostalgic. Like the All That fans like to freeze me in time, as if I'm still 15 years old, because maybe that was the best time in their life. And I'm all right with that. Whatever makes people happy. It's funny because when people meet me in real life, they expect me to be a goofy-faced jester. I'm actually surprisingly chill. I think I know why. I am a black man in America. You know what I'm saying? There is a burden of that life. People want the show 24/7, but there is no show. I have a sense of humor. If we speak about things and something funny comes up, we'll laugh and have a good time. But I'm not the guy that needs to be like, "Gather around, everybody." I'm basically a professional clown for hire. When the nose goes on, I turn on. When the nose comes off, I'm just a regular guy. A regular guy who's had a surreal life. Now that I'm older, boo, and wiser, yay! And a little jacked, thanks for noticing. I've been working on it. I'm ready to pull the curtain back, tell you some popping stories, and impart a little wisdom I've learned along the way. And hopefully, make you laugh. Give me those laughs. That's what I live for. Chapter 1. All That and a Bag of Chips. Growing up a middle-class kid in Georgia, I was a fan of the off-brand. We didn't drink Coke. We drank RC Cola. We didn't eat endless shrimp at Red Lobster. We ate super sampler platters at Long John Silver's. We didn't go to Disney World. We went to Six Flags. Give me Bugs Bunny over Mickey Mouse any day. You know what I mean? Disney Channel? No, not yet. Back then, I was a huge fan of Nickelodeon. It was a fledgling cable network for kids whose biggest star was Mark Summers, a hilarious dude in a suit and tie who hosted the game show Double Dare, and did spot-on Jimmy Stewart and Ethel Merman impressions that flew right over the heads of his pint-sized contestants. I also loved seeing a dude named Phil Moore host Nick Arcade. He was so happy-go-lucky, like the kids' version of Al Roker. And I got to know him later on, and he's one of the nicest guys in the world. He was never a different person when the cameras weren't rolling. He was always genuine, solid, and supportive. And a little bit nerdy. I love a black nerd. I loved how under the radar Nickelodeon was back then. And I loved all their shows, from You Can't Do That on Television to that eye-patch little freak known as Danger Mouse. I was a big Nick guy before it was popular. You could tell they were just trying to make their way and figure it out as they went. There was a slapdashy vibe about the whole network. And as an off-brand kind of guy myself, I appreciated that. So it was pretty surreal the very first day I walked onto the set of all that. Nickelodeon's second attempt at a sketch comedy show. Roundhouse was the first. An obscure show centered around the Any family. Everyone looked 32 years old. It included high-concept song and dance numbers. And it was, unsuccessfully, sued by Aaron Spelling for relentlessly poking fun at his daughter, Tori. I remember reading in People magazine that she had a bowling alley in her basement. I hadn't even known that that was possible. All that was going to start from scratch, be more straightforward, be more character-driven, basically an homage to Saturday Night Live, but starring actual kids. I was one of those kids. I was the tender age of 14, the very monumental day I walked onto the Universal Studios lot in Orlando, Florida. The first thing I saw was Jonathan Brandis's parking spot. At 17, he was the child star of the moment. He had starred in Sidekicks with Chuck Norris and Ladybugs with the legendary Rodney Dangerfield. Now he was filming the Steven Spielberg-produced Sequest DSV a few doors down from our set. Jonathan was a hero of mine. I idolized and admired all working child actors because they were hashtag goals. We didn't even know what a hashtag was at that point. When I first got started in showbiz, there wasn't really one specific project that I wanted to do. I just wanted to be like other kid actors that I saw and knew. I wanted one opportunity to make my stamp. My Mighty Ducks buddy, Brandon Adams, was in The Sandlot and The People Under the Stairs and played little Michael Jackson in Moonwalker. He was prolific. Damn, I mean, Shamon. Anyway, another one of my Mighty Ducks buddies, Aaron Lohr, was in Newsies. And I thought that was extra, extra. You get it? Extra, extra. Anyway, he was one out of 100 kids, but he was in the movie. Another guy I looked up to was Dante Basco, who played Rufio in Hook. Rufio! Yeah. I would have given my real right hand to have been a lost boy in that movie. David Krumholtz, man, seemed like this kid was in everything. He was in Life with Mikey and played Christina Ricci's boyfriend in Adam's Family Values. He was that kid who worked like a fiend, a go-to for films and commercials, and I envied him in a healthy, positive way. I finally met him about a year ago in a parking garage in New York, and he could not have been nicer. To be honest, I wanted to be all of them. A go-to face. The kind everybody knew from a young age as the little dude who had talent. My goal, always, from the beginning, was to start acting, then continue on without stopping or going away. So yeah, seeing Jonathan Brandis's parking spot was like a kid's version of seeing Graceland. I fangirled out inside my head. My first day of all that was a day I'll never forget. The memory's very vivid. Not only because of that first moment you know your life is changing, but also because they made us go to school first thing for 3 hours. How dare you? It wasn't very Hollywood to have to do linear equations at 8 a.m. And no, that's not a euphemism for cocaine. Guess I was the last one in the cast to get picked because when my mom and I got dropped off at the learning trailer, right outside our soundstage, everyone already seemed to know one another. I'd just come off filming D2 The Mighty Ducks, so I wasn't exactly a rookie, but I was a shy guy in general. I introduced myself, then quickly wedged myself into the corner. I admit I was intimidated by my new co-stars, even 10-year-old Katrina Johnson. There were 7 of us, ranging in age from baby Katrina up to 17-year-old Lori Beth Denberg. Lori Beth gave off fierce mama bear energy from day one. She seemed sophisticated, like the old wise sensei of the bunch, light years beyond the rest of us. Even though she had the least amount of experience in showbiz, she was damn near an adult already and had this mature vibe just beaming off her.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.